All right, guys, today I'm attempting the impossible, a sound design masterclass for you, everything from the basics to the advanced. We're going to try to do this in one take. It's Game from BusyWorksBeats.com. If you don't know me, I'm Game from BusyWorksBeats.com. We train over 900,000 producers around the world. So I'm going to work with Drake, Kanye West, Post Malone, Ariana Grande, French Montana, Young Thug, YG, Polo G, Lil Baby, J. Cole, Trippie Redd, a long list of folks that I'm not even naming. So shout out to you guys. Let's get hop right into the DAW. I'm going to show you everything from basic shapes, filters, noise, envelopes, modulation, wavetables, how to make your own drum kit, how to layer sounds, how to make pads, brass keys, leads, bass, and detuning and tuning options. So there's a lot to go through, but I promise to tackle these at least. And if you want the more deep experience, like step-by-step modular experience, go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. I'll leave a link below because we have free now, 14-day trial. For our sound design course. So let's open up Serum. So the first thing I like the sound design in is Serum because it has all the basics in here. Also, I'm going to give you another resource. The Lunch 77 drum kit is in our Discord. I'll leave a link below, but it's just busyworksbeats.com/Discord. You'll get all these drum kits from Metro Boomin to TM88 to Cardiac, you know, all the top producers basically have the drum kits right inside of here. So Lunch 77 handpicked those sounds. Okay, without further ado, let's start with sound design. So in Serum, if we go to Oscillator A, click on this little tab, go to Analog, we can switch this to Basic Shapes. So there are four main shapes in sound design. You have a sine wave, and let me show you the difference because without this understanding, you won't truly understand what's the difference between a sine wave, a pulse wave, a sawtooth. You're not going to understand unless you see what's called the frequency spectrum. So what I'm going to do is show you the frequency content of each sound. So a sine wave, if I just play a note, I don't know if you can see it, maybe my webcam's in the way, I can't see my own self, so. But if you look at this graph, it shows a single horizontal line. So that's a sine wave, it's called fundamental frequency because it doesn't have harmonic content. Okay, so in physics, you have something called a fundamental frequency. This is the core frequency of a sound. So it's going to be the lowest frequency that your thing is creating. So my voice, my lowest frequency may be 100 hertz, let's say. That's the fundamental frequency, the lowest frequency something creates. Now, when you start stacking up, you see my voice has all these frequencies in it. That's called harmonic structure. So what we do is we take the fundamental frequency and we multiply it. So for example, if I want to get to the second harmonic, I multiply 2 times the fundamental frequency. So in this case, if my root note is 100 hertz, then that means that the second harmonic is 2 times 100, which would make that 200 hertz is the second harmonic. And then on and on and on. The eighth harmonic is 8 times fundamental frequency. So that would make it 800. Okay, so the sine wave is just one frequency going across. Now, once we switch this using what's called the wavetable position. So if you click this window, you could actually see the wavetables that this has. It has a snapshot of each shape per wavetable position. Okay, so if you move this knob up, you'll get to the next wave, which is called a sawtooth. So a saw sound is very bitey. It's the most aggressive sound we have. Okay, and you noticed how this has a lot of horizontal lines. That's because a sawtooth has a stack of different harmonics. So we're taking that fundamental frequency and multiplying it over and over and over again until we get all these frequencies. Okay, so let's switch this shape and let's go to a triangle wave. This is called a triangle because it literally makes a triangle. Now notice we have horizontal frequencies, but they're not as yellow as before. They're a little faded when it goes up into those higher frequencies. That's because a triangle wave has upper harmonics, but they're diminished as you go higher and higher. So you don't get a very buzzy sound like a sawtooth. You get more of a muffled sound like this. If I were to cover my mouth with my hand, notice how some of those high-end frequencies disappear. The same thing. Look at my voice. Okay, now it's vibrant in those highs. But if I cover my hand with my mouth with my hand, I have less higher frequencies. That's because I'm blocking the higher frequencies from actually reaching the microphone. Okay, so the next thing we have is a pulse wave or a square wave. And this just has a different set of stacking frequencies on top of each other. So as you can see, every sound is different, not because of the shape, but because of the harmonic content that makes up that shape. So those are the main shapes. Again, to revisit, we have a sine wave, which is just the fundamental frequency. that single frequency. Then we have a sawtooth, which is very bitey and aggressive. Now we have a triangle wave, which is like a blend of a sine wave and a sawtooth. Like a subtle sawtooth. Next, we have a pulse wave, which is similar to a sawtooth, but different set of harmonics. Okay, so you get like a video game type sound when you use pulse waves for the most part. Now that you understand the basic shapes, let's get into filters. So filters, like I use my hand, that's a filter. I'm blocking the sound source. And so now you can't hear the high frequencies. So think of a filter, like a low pass filter, as allowing low frequencies to go beyond the filter, which is like my hand. The low frequencies go beyond my hand because they're longer than the higher frequencies. So they go beyond my hand. Okay, so let's go to filter. Let's go to normal and let's do 24 dB per octave. Basically, when you see these numbers, dB per octave, it just means how sharp the curvature is on this little cutoff thing right here. So if you want something a little harsher, go to 24. If you want it less harsh of a filter, put it on 6, which is a very subtle gradient. Let's try 24. Now, when I'm playing this note, let's play a sawtooth, for example, because again, remember, a sawtooth has a lot of harmonics. So similar to my voice, as soon as I cover my voice, you still hear my voice, but there's lower frequencies involved. We can do the same thing with a sawtooth. We could have a lot of frequencies and then cut away some of the high end using what's called a low pass filter. So here's the sawtooth without the filter. Here's the sawtooth with the filter. Now, if you move what's called a cutoff frequency, you can open up the filter to allow more and more higher frequencies. So look at the graph as I move this cutoff knob. So we allow more and more high frequency depending on what's called the cutoff frequency within this filter. You don't need to memorize names. Just understand that the cutoff frequency just allows more frequencies to come through depending on what type of filter it is. So if you move this knob, you'll hear usually a difference in the sound. Okay, whereas if you use a resonance knob, you may or may not hear a difference. Okay, so that's why I use that knob first. So let's get into some applicable sounds. So let's say, now I learned when I was learning Python that it's cool to learn the idea of stuff, but I wanted to know how to use it in real world stuff context. Okay, so let's scoot in, get your drinks of choice. Okay, so what I want to do, let's say I want the sound to go wow, like that, like wow. Like if I look at my voice, wow. Okay, so it's low pass, it opens and then it closes. Okay, so we're mimicking the human voice when we use filtering as well. So let's mimic that trait. So how do we control this knob? I can hit a note and do it manually using my mouse. I could record that automation. Technically, I could do it that way. But let's say I don't want to record the automation. I want to have it done for me within the synth. What we can do is control this knob with what's called an envelope. So this envelope can control different things within the synth. So let's drag this envelope over top of the thing we want to move. Instead of using our hands, let's use this envelope, a built-in thing that does stuff for us. So let's drag envelope 2 over the cutoff frequency. So wherever the pointer points to, that's the end point, okay? So whenever you forget where like the blue lines and stuff, always remember in Serum, wherever that pointer points to is the end point, okay? So the blue part is the starting point. So we need to tell this thing to go up because we want to start, close, go up, close back. So let's give it a small attack, which is how long it takes to go up to its highest value. Then we want to lower what's called sustain because we don't want to hold. We don't want to go wow. We want to go wow. Okay. So we're not sustaining the ah. Okay. We need to give it what's called a decay. So let's lower what's called the sustain so that we hear what's called decay. So if I play any key right now, here's what it sounds like. Sounds close, but it's a little too fast. Wow. Sounds like it needs more time to go from to the top. Wow. Like that. Okay, so right now it's going bow, and that's not what I'm doing. I'm not doing bow. Okay, so we need to increase the attack time to give it more time to build up. Even that's a little fast. So we're at around 500 milliseconds. And that's closer to what we were going for. Now, the problem is, when I go, wow, I'm not going all the way up to these higher frequencies. I'm going at max 10K, let's say. Okay, really, truly 1K. Okay, so what I need to do is I need to tell this envelope not to turn the knob up all the way and then come down. I just want to turn it up a little bit and then come down. So in Serum, we can hover over this little blue semicircle icon and then left click and drag it. So now I'm telling it how far up I want to turn the envelope. I don't want to turn it all the way to the right. I just want to turn it a little bit to the right. So now I'm going to pull in what's called the range. Okay, so let's left click and pull this range down. So I'm just going to lower this by listening to the sound. And now we're getting closer to what I was doing with my mouth. Wow, like that. Now you can see my voice has this dense yellow part. I'm not going to get into the particulars, but in this case, it needs amplification at those specific frequencies. That's where resonance would come into play. Okay, so this boost. So if you're confused about resonance, it basically just focuses wherever the cutoff frequency is, this knob here, the resonance adds a little EQ boost right at that point. So I'm going to exaggerate so you can hear it, but it's a lasery sound you hear with filter. So you see, as I start adding resonance, it's boosting that frequency, which makes this more dense of a yellow curvature. And it almost sounds like a human voice. Wow. Okay, that's because I'm mimicking human behavior. Now, to add more volume at that specific point, we would need different shapes and different filter types. So I'm not going to bore you with that. But you can turn up what's called the drive to just give it a little more volume. Okay, now let's introduce what's called noise. So when I'm speaking, you're hearing background noise. It's not just my vocal. You're hearing the room. You're hearing my computer. Okay, you're hearing a lot of things. So to make something sound more natural, we add what's called white noise or noise of an environment. So if you click over here where it says noise, this activates whatever noise we load up. So right here, if you click this icon, you can switch out the different types of noise. So there's AC hum, which is the air conditioner hum. You have air cans, paper bags, a shush, wind chimes, paper bags, whatever. So let's just start with the basic AC hum. Now they also have analog white noise. So you can go to analog and try out the different white noise samples here. So let's start out with white noise. So what is noise? You see on the graph, noise is randomization of frequency. So it's unconcentrated frequency. It's the sound you hear when a TV goes static. It's because all the frequencies are just randomly going through the electricity. Okay, so it's just random. So what we need to do is, you may think that white noise is pointless, but white noise is actually used to fill in the gaps of sound. So what we can do is send this noise through this filter to add more density. Think of it like when you have a sidewalk and you have those little indents in the sidewalk, you need to fill it up with concrete. So think of white noise as like that filler, that stuff that goes in between the sidewalk, okay? So let's add this noise. We need to add it to our filter by turning this little button on that says N. So now the noise filter will go through, the noise will go through this filter. Okay, so now you can't hear the noise because it's being muffled by the filter. But if you wanted to hear it more pronounced, you would turn up what's called the level of the noise. And now you can hear it going like that. It sounds like we're in the Atlantic Antarctica. It goes okay, so part of when you say S is not a frequency, it's noise. It's unconcentrated air going through your teeth. S. Whereas if I whistle, S. Okay, we focus on a frequency and we push that frequency out. Whereas S is allowing multiple frequencies to come through. So with noise, it's a little unfocused. So the more noise you push through, the more unfocused the tuning is. So I can pull this back so it's not so aggressive. Okay, and I'm blending it into where you can barely tell it's even there. It just fills out that sound. So that's the purpose of noise. We can get into noise later in the application. Now let's try different envelopes. So now that you understand how we can use this envelope to control a cutoff frequency, let's tell another envelope, envelope 3, to control another aspect of the sound. So I'm not going to mimic the wow sound anymore. Let's just create a sound from scratch. So let's start all the way over. Let's go to initialize preset from the menu. Okay, so we have a sawtooth here. So the initial envelope 1 that you see in Serum is tied to the amplitude. So different parameters in audio need control from an envelope for the most part because it's controlled voltage. So what we can do here is the first envelope controls the volume. So if I pull up the attack, what's called the attack time, this delays the sound from getting up to its highest volume. So it's like, then it goes up to the highest volume. It's like going like that. Okay, so that's the attack time. How much time it takes to get up to the actual value of the volume. Whereas decay time is how long it takes to go down to the lowest volume set. Well, not the lowest volume set, depends on your sustain. But let's say I have sustain off. Decay determines how long it takes to go from the top of the sound to the bottom. So now it's like, ding, and then it lowers the volume. So think of a bell. Okay, whereas attack time is more of like a string. Okay, so let's turn up the attack. And then let's focus on a sound with a lower a decay curvature. So there's two shapes. This is called concave curvature. Whenever we go into something where it's like a cut into, that's called concave. Whereas convex is when we have something that's outward like this. So it's unorthodox to see stuff be a convex shape, but just to give you options on how to shape, it doesn't always need to look like this. It can look like this as well. Okay, so there's different curvatures for decay time. Now, sustain is basically what volume do you want to hold forever? So if I hold a note, see how it doesn't decay all the way down to zero? It stops at the sustain value until I let go of the key. Okay, and then I let go of the key and it gives us a release time. So the release time is when I let go of, when I release the key, how long does it take to fade all the way to zero? So decay time is how much time it takes to go from the top of the sound to the sustain point, if I have sustain on. And then depending on how long I hold the note, once I let it go, the release triggers. So here's the decay curvature. Here's the sustain level. And then I'm gonna let go of the key. That's called the release time. So there's different segments of time that we can use to shape a sound. And I'll get into like the different ways we would use that with drums, for example. So that's an envelope. So now let's use this envelope to start doing stuff. So envelopes are used to control parameters without me having to manually turn knobs. Okay, so let's tell envelope two, let's use our filter that we had. Let's switch this here to, let's try a different type. Let's go to miscellaneous, distorted comb, one low pass. I like the sound. And let's give envelope two control over the cutoff frequency. Now you see this time around, it doesn't have a blue line going to one side. It has a blue line going to both sides. It's bipolar in this case. So remember that wherever you point, that's the end point. So long story short, pull in your range. Okay, and then let's give this a decay curvature. Let's lower the sustain. And if you want more volume at that cutoff point, turn up resonance. Okay. And this one has a special knob called comb frequency. You could use this to shape the tone. Hear that like cool sound we get? This is great for EDM. So I like it around there. Okay, so now that we have that set, let's start building out our core sound. So let's use all the things we know so far. That was the filter, we've learned that. Let's go to our basic shapes and change out the shape. So we need to go here, switch it to analog, basic shapes. There are a lot of other shapes that they provide in Serum, so you can experiment. But under basic shapes, let's go to a triangle wave. So let's change this to the triangle shape. Okay, now let's move into adding noise. So let's click on the noise icon, click here, go to analog, white noise. Now we want the white noise to go through our filter. So let's click on the little N icon. And now we can't really hear the noise unless we turn it up. So I like that kind of filling sound. Let's actually pull this back to a sawtooth. I'm gonna switch between a saw and a triangle. Okay, so now what I wanna do is add some notes. So let's go to our piano roll and just add in, let's make a chord. This is an A minor chord. Nothing too crazy. A, and let's do it in multiple octaves so you can hear the voicing of this. Okay, so now we have the actual tone. When you sound design, the cool part is if you have MIDI in the background, you can have the MIDI run. I usually sound design with arpeggiators or chords in the background or melody. So I'll drag some MIDI inside of a piano roll and I'll sound design as the stuff is playing. So now let's figure out what part of the sound don't we like. The noise is a little too heavy. It's too like, okay. So I'm gonna pull that level back. I want the filter to be a little bit brighter, so let's grab this blue range and left click and drag it up a little bit. Now it sounds cool. So also, we're gonna move into a couple more things. This is kind of beyond the scope, but there's something called a unison tab here. This adds more than one sound generating thing. So if I have this at 4, we now have 4 things making sound, and it makes the sound bigger. So if we use detune, we could pull this down to make it a little more harsh. Okay, you can do a lot of cool stuff. I'll just show you how far you can take it, and then we'll move into the next portion, which is all about modulation. So this technically, this is modulation. Let's activate oscillator B. And what we want to do, we just want to use oscillator B's shape to control something else. So in sound design, when I speak about modulation, I mean that one sound is controlling the shape of another sound. So let's go to oscillator B, turn off the level, because we don't want to hear oscillator B. We just want oscillator B's shape to modulate oscillator A. All that means is we're going to turn the level down and we're going to go to oscillator A. Click here, go to FM from B. So FM stands for frequency modulation. So this means we're going to have oscillator B shaking oscillator A, basically. Like imagine your little brother and you're just shaking him. So when he's talking, he's like, that's basically what oscillator B is doing. It's just shaking oscillator A. So now we go from FM from B. And if I turn this up, you're going to hear more of an EDM type sound. Okay, now it's hard to hear because we have a very short decay curvature. But basically, this shape is controlling that shape. So let's switch this shape, oscillator B. Let's make the big brother, which is oscillator B, the controlling frequency. Let's make that an analog sine wave. Okay, now if I pitch this up, it's octave. You'll get different harmonic results. So the higher you go with the bigger brother, like the faster he shakes his little brother, the more metallic the sound becomes. So you hear that more, that metallic tone. If I grab that octave and I keep pulling up. So if I lower the octave of the big brother, you get a cool, now we're shaking the brother, but it's not as fast. So you're like shaking him like this as opposed to shaking him like this. Okay. So the lower the oscillator slows down the shaking of the little brother. So I like this tone. It's very thick. Okay, so now we know what modulation can do. Let's go back to our shape and let's switch this to what's called a wave table. So I showed you how if you click in the picture here, it shows you what's called the wave table of, or the image of the entire wave table. So if I switch this to, let's see, what's a wave table built in? Let's go to analog and let's try the Moog. I think this is their wave table. So we have basic Moog. That's what MG stands for, I believe, Moog. So you can see here, if I click the icon, it's a wave table. So you're like, what is this 3D looking thing? Basically, if I move this wave table position knob, I get a different shape. Okay, so it took a picture, a moving picture. So you know how on like your iPhone, you could take a live picture or you could take a regular static picture. So back in the old days, we could only take static pictures. So it's like, yo, what up? Okay, and that was the picture. But now you can get the whole experience. So now when you hit play on your live photo, it's like, yo, what up? And then you like walk away. You can see every frame in a certain amount of time. The same thing with the wavetable position. It's capturing multiple pictures in a certain amount of time. So we can select which picture we want it to play, basically, using what's called the wavetable position here. And I'm going to use this wavetable knob to cycle through the wavetable as the sound moves. So we can assign an envelope or something to control this wavetable. So let's say you want an envelope. Let's drag envelope 2 over top of the wavetable position. And whenever you get confused, remember that wherever that knob points to, that's the end point. Okay, so this envelope is going to start at the high blue value and it's going to go down to that white pointer value. Okay, so it's basically going to start at the back of the wave and then move forward on this picture by default. So now we're getting this cool, like wide sound. And it's unique because it's changing the sound as we go through the sound. So now you get a really unique sound. And without the white noise, here's what it sounds like. It sounds cool, but it doesn't sound as alive. So white noise is that glue inside the sidewalk that I talked about. So now that we have our chord making thing, let's give this a little chord progression. Let's do A minor, then let's do like some really big chords like D minor 9 or something crazy. And then let's do, what else has E in it? Let me think. A, let's do F major 7. You don't need to know any of this. I'm just showing you. But if you do want to learn music theory, just go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. I'll leave a link below because we have a 14-day free trial for all our courses from sound design to music theory. And you, I will show you where music theory is applied to sound design. Dun. Okay, then I want that last note to be D. So let me think. We could do, let's make this a minor chord. And that's cool. Okay. Now, if you want to make this EDM, we're going to take what's called the third and then hit control up. Okay, so now that we have stuff in the background, I'm just going to add a little tiny melody so we can hear the melody play as we're just sound designing. Let me pause the video for you. All right, so I think the melody's pretty decent. So here's the beginning. Okay, so when you're sound designing, you're not going to get a perfect sound right away. Chances are you need to, you know, chip away at certain things. So right now, I think that it's too noisy. It's too like that. So let's just pull the noise back. Okay, next up we have what's called a sub oscillator. So this is, let's say your sound is a little too thin. You could thicken it up with what's called a sub oscillator. The only issue is that because I'm playing so many notes, it adds a sub octave to every single note, which means it's thickening it up, but it's every note. So even my bass notes are going to get sub octaves, which makes it almost too thick of a sound. So this is a sine wave, and you could switch out the wave types. Now that sounds really cool because we're using a sawtooth as opposed to this sine wave. Okay, now you can lower what's called the octave of that sub frequency. So now this will add that muddiness. That's if I go down one more octave. See how muddy it gets? Nah, sticky it gets. Okay, so we're just going to keep it in the higher octave, which basically we're just adding a sine wave to the salt wave to the sound. Now let's say it's too bright. You can add the sub oscillator into the filter with this S button here. So now it has the same movement as the original sound, so it blends in. We're just adding it in. But it adds that bite that we need to bring back that sound. Like the sound. So let's say you want to save it, click on the save icon, and then let's save this as Saw Masterclass. And maybe I'll give this to you for free. Just go to, where can you go to get this for free? busyworksbeats.com/FL Studio. I'll leave a link below if I remember, and I'll upload this into the Dropbox. Actually, go to our Discord. Forget everything I said. Just go to our Discord, discord.gg/busyworksbeats. I have them in both places, but it's easier to get in our Discord. So now the sound feels good. It feels alive. It doesn't feel stagnant. Okay, so now we're going to move into, I'm going to quickly touch on effects because effects are really about taste. But if you click on the effects tab, and I meant to add in the mod matrix here. So actually, before we get to the effects, let's go to mod matrix. I'll just show you a couple things here, but this is basically where you can visually see what controls what. So you know how I drag those envelopes over top of the filter? Here's where you can account for what you actually did dragging those knobs everywhere. So this is just a different way of looking at what you already modulated by dragging and dropping. But in the matrix, you can also do cool things. I'll just show you one of the cool things is switch this to note on alternative, change your destination. So it's saying, what's the source of control? What thing is trying to control something else? So you have a built-in function called note on alternative, which means that it cycles between left and right every time you hit a note. So if I hit a note one time, it's going to be left. I can hit the same note and it'll pan it right, depending on our settings. So let's set it to oscillator A, which is the thing making sound. And let's go to oscillator A volume. This is just a little boutique thing you could do. And let's go left and right type. So it will have bipolar. You don't need to memorize the words. Okay, just pull up the amount. So now when I hit a note, it pans to either left or right. And that widens out the sound. If you have a smaller sound, that can widen out a sound. Make your sound more dynamic because it could be on the left or it could be on the right. It just makes it feel wider. Okay, now let's go to effects. I'm going to quickly touch on effects. You don't need to memorize the effects. Every plugin has different effect sets. Here, I'll just quickly go through what each does. Hyper basically has two sections, a detuning section, which does the same thing as like a unison would. Okay, but just through effects. But I'm going to turn that mix level down. Mix level means how much of the effect do you actually want? We're blending in the effect and the original sound. It's called a mix. Okay, so dimension is how it's like a tiny little bit of reverb. So if I turn this up, it's going to make my sound feel like it's in a small room. It's going to make it a little bit bigger. And I like it that big. So that's a cool sound. Now, distortion completely rips apart the sound. And use this with caution, but basically you just turn up the drive. And you can switch out the distortion type here. In short, distortion adds more harmonic content. I'm going to put this on tape saturation. See how it just rips the part? Rips the sound. I don't necessarily like that sound, so I don't like distortion for this specific sound. Flanger creates this like 70s vibe. Sounds like wishy-washy. Phaser is very similar, it just has a different style movement. This feels like it's floating around your head. Chorus basically is similar to those, but less extreme. It makes sounds feel like detuned, like an old piano. Travis Scott type vibe. So I like to blend in chorus every now and again. Because the sound's already wide, we don't need a lot of chorusing because it's already doing its own chorusing. Delay is like delay, delay, delay. Delay, delay, delay. So it's just repeating itself. For this sound, we don't need that. We just don't need delay. We don't need more of the sound. Compressor is basically it tames the sound. So that it's not like up and down and up and down. Now, what most people don't realize is a multi-band mode. So this squashes the sound in a different way. It gives it that EDM type sound. So if you want that EDM touch, click on the multi-band under compressor. I don't want that EDM type sound for the sound. We're going to click on reverb, and this will just make the sound feel like it's in a big room. It adds emotion to the sound, that's for sure. Feels like the sound is crying, telling us all its pain. EQ is like if you want to just touch up some of the high end or the low end, you could lower the gain or raise the gain. So let's say it's too bright, you could just lower the gain here. Or you could have something control that. So let's say you want to control that knob, grab your LFO tool, for example, or an envelope and just drag, or velocity or note value, and you could drag it over top. So let's be unique. Let's go note value and let's drag that over top the EQ. So depending on what note I play on the keyboard, it determines the value of the gain for this knob. So the higher the note, the more EQ it adds. The lower the note, the more it gets muffled. So that way the sound moves in a really unique way. And lastly, you have a filter that overrides everything. And here they have a secret knob called that drive knob. This can add a lot of low end to your sound. If you have a low bass, try using the drive knob on this filter here. Really thickens up that bass. Let's save this. So notice how I'm saving different versions of the same sound because I like each stage of the sound. So we went through modulation, wavetables, envelopes, noise, filters, basic shapes, and effects. You learned a lot in that very short amount of time. That's a real world example of what you can do with sound design. Now we're going to get into building kicks like drums. Now I'm going to give you the basics of it. I'm not going to go into depth because it does take time. Now, if you want the full course, just go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. You can now get a 14-day free trial for all of our courses. We have 60 music production courses at the moment, specifically on sound design, music theory, beat making, mixing, mastering. And we have one dedicated to how to make your own drum kit and like really deep sound design. So I'm going to show you the basics, but it goes way deeper than what I'm about to show you because it requires effects and different things. So let's start building our own drums around this. So let's add this into the song mode. Let's open up another serum. All right, so I'll try to cover Foley. Don't mind the background landscapers. They're whacking the grass, the weeds or whatever. Okay, so we have Foley layering. Okay, and I said I was going to get into pads, leads. So I would say the first sound we made was a pad. Let's label this as pad. Okay, we have the pad. Now let's make a kick drum. So a kick drum is, let me pause the video actually so this guy can go by. All right, I think he's done. I think he went by. I don't know. Okay, so for a kick drum, remember that all sounds start with what's called a fundamental frequency. So similar to my voice. Okay, if we open up that Wave Candy plugin again in FL Studio. I'm not sure if you can buy Wave Candy for other dolls or what. But my voice has the lowest frequency in it, which is around 100 hertz. And then it has a stack of those harmonic frequencies, which are multiples of the fundamental frequency. So with a kick drum, we want it to be based around what's called the fundamental frequency. And you're not going to, most of the time, you're not going to make a kick drum with a sawtooth. Okay, it's too bitey and it's not round enough. So let's switch this wave type. Let's go to analog bass drum sine wave. Okay, so a sine wave is going to give you the most boom for your sound. So if you want boom in your kick, you need a sine wave somewhere in there because that's going to give you that fundamental frequency that doesn't have that harmonic stack over top of it. So now that we know where we need to start, which is a sine wave, we need to shape the sine wave. So let's go back to our principles of using that envelope to shape out the sound. So right now, if I hold the note, it's just playing forever. Okay, we wanted to, a kick drum goes poof, poof. It doesn't play poof, unless it's an 808. Okay, so we wanted to have a shape to it. So let's lower what's called the sustain so that we have what's called decay curvature. And now when I hit notes, now sound design like this. Now here's how I actually sound design kicks. I'll draw in a little dot in the pattern so I can hear the curvature of the kick as I go. Okay, so what's wrong with the sound? It's too high up. I don't want my kick to go boo, boo. Okay, I want it to go boom. So let's lower the oscillator to two octaves. So now we're somewhere closer, but we're not done. This isn't it. So what gives punch to the kick? What gives punch to the kick is actually an envelope over the pitch. Okay, so it's like going wee, but fast. Okay, so let's, now if we were to control that, I would have a pitch knob and I'd be turning it down. But instead of me doing that, I want the envelope to do it for me. So I need to tell the envelope to turn something down very fast. In this case, we want it to decay or turn down envelope 2 we're using. And then we're going to drag this over top of our coarse pitch, which is like the overall pitch of a sound. You have different pitch stages. You have octave, semitone, fine tune values. Long story short, just use the coarse pitch because this gives you the most range for your pitch for the sound. Okay, so now it goes pew. But I don't want an EDM kick. I don't want an EDM kick that's beew. I just want it to go poof. So what we need to do is lower the decay. Now I'm going to raise the octave so you can hear the actual. So, okay, so if we lower the decay, This is like Mario Land. Okay, then we keep pulling the decay down further and further until it gets tighter. Okay, until that pitch bend is almost indistinguishable. Now we can lower our oscillator back down. That's where the punch of the kick comes from. So when people tell me how to add punch to the kick, I'm like, it's in the sound design. You can't EQ that in. Okay, now we still have to do stuff to the kick. And that's why I said in the full course, I go over like all the little stuff. You still have to mix this and do a lot of stuff to it. I'll give you some shortcuts, but again, you need to probably get the full course to understand everything about drum kit sound design. There's a couple things you could do. Let's go to analog. Let's go to basic shapes. And now we want to modulate this sound over here. So let's go to sine wave. We're going to turn the level down and we're going to click on the warp mode. Let's go to FM from B. So we're telling the big brother to shake the little brother basically again. And we're going to turn off the level of oscillator B. Okay. And then we're going to turn up the FM amount. I'm going to exaggerate so you can hear. See how it adds that metallic frequency in there? Okay, we're doing that because we want to add tonality to the kick, but in a very abstract way to fill it out. Okay, so a very small amount. Now, what you can also do is give the envelope control over the FM amount. So remember, wherever that white pointer points to, that's the end point. Okay, I dragged envelope 2 over this, and I'm just going to left click and pull this down. So now it goes from a lot of FM to a little FM in a very short amount of time. And this can add a little bit of extra knock to your kick. I'm going to exaggerate so you can hear, but then I'm going to pull it back. Okay, we do that with a UK bass as well. Okay, so it's very subtle. You can barely tell. If I didn't really map it out, you might not have noticed. But it's like a little tone. It goes doop, doop. Okay, so now let's start using filters to beef up the sound because we want to now blend all these sounds into one thing. So I'm going to add some noise because I feel like we need to add some filler. Let's add some white noise. Now, instead of going psh, psh, the noise doesn't have a built-in envelope. It's not controlled by any envelope. So the level is just on. Okay. It's controlled by the amp envelope, and that's it. So what we need to do is tell this noise to go through the filter. Now, again, I'm going to exaggerate so you can hear the noise. So it was like, psh, psh. Okay, but we're going to pull this back so it's not as evident. Okay, you can even mess with the pitch if you want to shape the, I guess, the bias of the noise. So if it's too bright, you can lower this down. Now to me, let me turn off the filter for a second. This is the noise without, with that low pitch. So you got to be careful how low you go because you can wobble the kick drum if you make it too low. I think this is enough. And then we can pull the level back. Let's blend that in with the oscillator A. Filter on. And then lower the amount. Okay, so it's super subtle. You can't even really tell that it's there. So if you want the kick to be a little more shapely, you can pull up what's called the decay curvature. Okay, to make it sustain a little bit more. But the kick still needs something. So what we can do is go to our effects, go to filter. And here's what I said about the low end. If you just use the drive knob here, we can push the kick a little bit harder. And you start to feel that punch come out from the kick. Now we can hear the noise a little bit more. So we would go back to the noise, turn that down. Okay. And you can experiment with different levels of FM. Okay. Now, let's lower the decay curvature of the kick so it's not so long. If you hear a little click, you can pull up what's called the attack. Sometimes that click makes the sound feel a little synthetic. But then if you have too much attack, you lose the punch. So you gotta, there's a fine line with this attack. Okay, so at this point, you would run it through a bunch of effects. From compression to saturation to clippers. I'm just going to show you one because I don't have enough time to really go through everything about everything right now. So what we're going to do is use that as the source. Now you're like, that's a kick drum. But what we can do is use Fruity Soft Clipper and drive the sound through here. So let's turn the threshold up, go to the kick, and now turn this up in volume. So now you get more of a crunch. And the harder you push the kick, the more crunch you're going to get. Now that's too much crunch, in my opinion. So I'll pull this back. And you have to ask yourself, what about the sound don't you like? It's probably too long, in my opinion. And too much high frequency. So this is where I would muffle it with a low pass filter. Okay, so we're pushing this. The more drive you get, the more squared off the waveform is. So let me push it just so you can see the actual what's happening. So here's before I start driving the volume. I want to show you how less harmonic content sounds versus more. So here's before. Now look at how high the kick goes. Not so high. We can turn up the volume. We're getting more and more high frequencies involved. Get more and more high frequencies, okay? And that's what I mean by saturation. We're adding that harmonic content to the sound. Okay, now you can add a sub oscillator. And then have that run through our filter. But here you're gonna, you gotta watch clipping, okay? So remember, the sine wave is gonna give you that fundamental frequency, that boom. So it's very hard to hear, but it's three octaves down. Okay, now this is also how 808s are made. So we're not going to get into everything about everything because it will take too much time. So I'll make this basic kick for now. It still needs a lot of shaping, but let's just add it in the mix. So I go over again in the course how to make that sound more complete. Okay, so let's move into the snare, and then we're going to make a hi-hat. Let's open up Serum. Okay, now snares are, if you think about a snare, it goes chhh. So it's usually white noise. Okay, so it's some tonality, but it's also noise. It's very noisy of a sound. So let's start off with white noise first. Okay, let's turn off oscillator A. We're going to start with white noise. Okay, and then we're going to program where a snare would usually go. Now this is similar to Kanye's, or I think it was Travis Scott or Kanye West, I think it was Travis Scott, who had a white snare, a white noise as a snare. Now it doesn't end because remember it has a sustain value. So we need to go in and actually turn down the sustain. So now we have a decay curve. So we're going to turn this up. But a snare doesn't go, it goes. So let's lower the decay. But it's not full. So the question is, how do we make this more full and sound more like a snare? So let's give it more level on the noise. So I'm showing you noise first, because once you master noise, you can understand where hi-hats come from. Let's go to our effects and let's use that EQ to start shaping the tonality of this snare. So the first thing I want to do is try switching this to a bell curvature. So this allows me to focus on a very specific frequency. And if I turn up the gain here, you'll see a little blip show up. Now, as I turn this volume up, you'll notice that it goes from to like that, because now we're starting to shape that white noise into a singular frequency, the same way I go from S to S. Okay, that's because I'm closing in that frequency, that resonant point. Now the sound goes instead of just, it goes. So just boost your EQ gain in this specific spot to give tonality to your snare. Let's go to the effects tab and let's start distorting the sound. Now, I don't recommend inside Serum effects, but let's drag the distortion. You can drag the effects in the order, because the first thing I want to do is give it that. The second thing I want to do is like chop off the top of the sound using what's called tape saturation. So we're going to click on this distortion and click on the drop down, go to tape saturation and turn this up. You can't really tell the difference there because it's not, there's no tonality except the noise. So let's go back to oscillator A and let's create the second part of a snare, the second portion of a snare. Let's click this, go to analog, let's go to analog sine wave. And now we're going to create the bottom end of a snare. So the snare has the top part, top mic, and then you have the bottom mic. So this is going boom, and it's going ch at the same time. So it creates a pching. I can't do it all at the same time. Okay, so now let's give this a frequency. So let's say we want it to be a little more bassy. Let's pull it down an octave. Now with this frequency, if I turn off the noise, this is where you'll start to hear that saturation come in. Because now it's not just do, it's a little saturated because we ran it through this effect here. So it's not just the sine wave. Let me turn off the other stuff for a second so you can see. Look at the harmonics we get. So if I turn this distortion off, it's going to give us a basic sine wave. Okay, but if I crank the distortion on, it's a little more buzzy. Okay, so that's going to give that aggressive sound to the snare. Let's turn on all the noise again. Let's lower the decay curvature. So the snappier the snare you want, lower your decay. If you want the snare to go, give it a longer decay curvature. Now remember, you have a decay curvature. You have a way to make it concave or convex, so you could always pull this up. So that's, you know, the majority of a snare. You can compress the snare. Doesn't really add much with the compressor there. So what I would do from this point is use more EQ to shape the tone and then run it through some type of tape saturation to really get it. You could also run it through a soft clipper. So let's hit Control L, send this to the mixer. Let's open up a Fruity soft clipper or any clipper you like. Turn up the threshold. And then you can boost the volume going into. So if you want more volume, go to your serum patch, go to the cog icon, go to your wrench icon, and then use this volume multiplier here. And this is going to give it more like distortion. So you got to really mess with that decay curvature. Now, one thing I forgot to mention was the pitch envelope. Okay, so if you want more knock to your snare the same way you do with the kick, you would add an envelope over the pitch. So you can grab envelope 2, drag it over top coarse pitch, and then lower your sustain. So again, it goes like that. But then you're just shaping how fast. And this adds that punch to the kick. So now it's a matter of just shaping the EQ. So this is super clipping right now. So I'm going to add that soft clipper. I forgot we boosted the volume like a gazillion percent. So let me turn off the volume increase. Okay, so that's how you make snares. Really, at this point, it's just a matter of EQ. I just don't have enough time to sit here and really mess with the EQ. But if you wanted a broader frequency range, you can mess with what's called the Q curvature in the EQ. So if you want it more noisy instead of like very tonal snare, you would move this to the right. It'll make it very tonal. If you want it less tonal, pull this to the left. Which is like our snares that we have there. So here's the snare. So let's say you want to print this snare out. Like, how do you make it into a one shot? There's a hidden function in the top left of Serum. If you just hover over here, it says drag to export, and then just drag this into your DAW. You now have a snare sample right here. So now you can use this instead of using MIDI. You could actually use your sample, and you could even mangle it even further. So now let's go over here and let's just add this into the grid. And it looks exactly like the snares you guys use everywhere else. It's based on white noise and then those pitch envelopes. So here's what the snare would look like. And then if you wanted to save this, you would just right click, edit in audio editor. Just if you want to like look at it even further and just save it, click here, go to save sample as, and just save this wherever. Let's just save it on our desktop, call it snare. And if you want to add the metadata, you would right click on this little tab up top. And then type in snare to your website, you know, busyworksbeats.com, sample rates already included, blah, blah, blah. Hit save and then resave that as snare and then save, replace. So now it has the metadata on the actual sample. Okay, so that's what a snare looks like. Okay, that's what it sounds like by itself. There's a thousand things we could do to fix it to make it bigger. Okay, so how do you print out the kick, for example? Let's go back to our kick. Same deal, go to the top left of Serum, drag this out as a one shot, and now you have your kick. You could visually look at the kick, just like any other kick, but now you can treat it as if it's a sample, which now you can go to pre-computed effects and boost this, for example, for more knock. And you can clip it for more square tones. I wouldn't recommend clipping it because it makes it kind of too boxy. But you could boost the sound here to add more and more grittiness to the sound. So if it's not knocking, you could use that right there. So in this case, we would save this as, let's edit an audio editor, right click, call this kick, and just say BusyWorks Beats, can't spell today, BusyWorksBeats.com. 44, hit save, and then go to the top left, save sample. Just gonna save it to the desktop called kick. Okay, so now we have kick and snare, but the cool part is because we transform this to audio, we can now go in and do stuff in the sampler that we can't do in Serum, like do the pre-computed effects, for example. So I'm going to get rid of these and load up the kick into a sampler, because right now it's not in a sampler, it's just as audio. I want it inside of a sampler. I think actually it allowed me to do pre-computed effects without a sampler, so I stand corrected. But let's send this to the mixer, hit Control L to send it to the mixer, and I'm going to send it through a plugin I like called T-Rex Classic Clipper. This one, we're going to put it on hard clip mode. So now when I run the kick through, we get a little more punch out of it with that classic clipper. I think it has a better sound than the Fruity Soft Clipper. So let's go to pre-computed effects, turn up boost a little bit. And now it's going through the classic clipper. I'm pushing it pretty hard. I usually don't push it that hard. Okay, so let's make some hi-hats. Okay, so we have kick, snare, hi-hat. We'll make an 808. I said this is a big, ambitious video. Okay, so let's go to pattern 3 now. Let's go to Serum. I'm going to move a little bit quicker here because we go over this in our full course at premium.busyworksbeats.com. We have a full how to make your own drum kit. Let's go to default to make this. Actually, we don't need this right now. Let's just go to noise. Okay, so we have this. But a hi-hat goes t. It doesn't go t. Okay, so we need to give it what? Decay. So let's lower sustain. And then the decay is too long, so let's lower the decay. Now this is where hi-hat starts, is a simple noise decay. Now again, I'm going to switch this type to white noise. So it's a little more, it's a different noise profile. Let's right click our pattern, go to fill each two steps for now, and just draw in a pattern. Now we can call it a day with just that, but question is, how do you get more out of the hi-hat? So let's go to our filters. Let's go to high pass filter. Let's go to 24 dB per octave. Turn it on. And we want the noise to go through the filter. So the high pass filter works different than the low pass in that it cuts out the low frequencies. So we're going to cut off the lows. and then turn up what's called a resonance here, which is basically an EQ boost. And that's how you get the tone out of your hi-hat. You can even have this move. That's a pretty cool sound. But let's just say we want the hi-hat to have a tone right here. So what people don't understand is that when you have noise and you start to filter it, you can actually turn it into a frequency. Okay, so the more resonance you have, the more frequency that noise becomes. So the cutoff filter is becoming my tuning knob, essentially. So the more resonance you want, the more tonal it gets. Now from this point, we're going to add that EQ to continue to shape the sound. There's many ways to fill up the sound of a hi-hat. You can also try out, this is more advanced, okay, so I'm not going to recommend this, but you could also try using, I'm just going to show the more advanced folks, two sine waves, turn off oscillator B, and have oscillator B, again, the bigger brother, shake the little brother at a high frequency. It creates this metallic type sound. But you have to know how to like really hand tune it. So that's how you get a little more density in your sound using sine waves there. And remember, because we're using a high pass filter, we're not hearing the low frequencies that this would generate. Here's without the filter. You would hear this doop, 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 doop sound. This is also how you get that doot, 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 tom sound. You just add a low pass filter in this case. Let's save this as percussion bass because I might add some tom drums in here. But once you add that filter, that's what takes it into hi-hat range. There we go. So then you just boost it. You do the same thing, run it through a classic clipper. And again, once from here, you can go to the top left. Okay, drag the one shot out. And then you have it as a one shot. And this will allow you to add those pre-computed effects that we had. Now, I don't draw my hi-hats in like this, okay? But I'm just showing you what we could turn it into. We could normalize it. Okay, we could add boost. We could add a fade out to make it shorter. So you could do a lot cooler stuff when you have it as audio than you can with MIDI. So let's see what we could do. We need to insert this into a sampler. I'm going to move a little bit quicker here. We're going to open up an empty sampler so that we can play the note. And then we're going to drag the audio into the sampler. So we're going to grab this hi-hat, just drag it into the sampler. So now I can use it like any other instrument. And we're going to hit, we're going to add notes for it. So now I can go in the sampler and now turn up the volume manually or fade it out, whatever I want to do. That's a little bright. Doesn't have a lot of body, so what we could do is pitch it down. So that's the hi-hat. Now let's make an 808. Now again, 808s take a lot of back and forth time, so I'll just show you the general basics. It's similar to a kick, but the only difference is that we have a different decay curvature. So let's go here. Oscillator A. We're going to move a little bit quicker because, again, I'm going over the basics over and over and over again. We have a sine wave. Again, if you want the full course, go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. I'll link it below. You have a 14-day free trial to all our courses, 60 music production courses, including sound design and how to make your own drum kit. Let's lower this down. So now we have that Okay, that's the fundamental frequency we need. And what about an 808? An 808 goes boom, boom, boom. It doesn't go boom. It goes boom, boom. Okay, it hits and then it goes away. So let's add this in. We need to make an envelope to tell it to turn off over time. Let's go to envelope one, lower the sustain. This only controls the volume by default. So right now it's just going boom, boom, boom. It's hard to hear the pitch, so let's... So that's what it's doing right now. Doom, doom, doom. Okay, so pretty basic. So the question is, how do we thicken this up? Let's go to song mode so we can hear it. So we already have it lowered and we have the volume, but this isn't enough for an 808 as far as a modern 808 sound. Maybe back in the day. Okay, so we need to start adding a punch to the sound. How do we add punch? We add another envelope to the pitch. So let's go to envelope two, lower sustain so that it has a decay curvature, drag envelope two over the coarse pitch, and now we'll go pew. But 808s that I use don't go pew, they just do boo. Okay, so lower the decay to make it more punchy. Okay, now if it's, you can also mess with the range here, so you can left click and pull this up to increase the range. Make it more like clicky. Now the higher you go, the more lasery it sounds. So there's a sweet spot in here. Okay, so again, if you hear clicks, try messing with your attack curvature. And also, now we want to fill out the tonality of the sound. Right now it's cool, it hits, but it doesn't have like a thing to it. Let's go to oscillator B, grab a sine wave, turn the sine wave off. We just want it to control oscillator A, FM from B. And you're like, why would I add this tone? It's to thicken up the sound. Now what we can do is add an envelope to FM from B and then lower the amount. So it adds more of that perception of knock to the sound. But 808s also have a body to them. So let's pull up the sustain curvature. They don't just go boom. So now we can hear that pitch a little bit more. I want to lower the range because it sounds too like ew, ew, ew. Okay, so let's lower that. So this is the fine tuning that you got to go back and forth with. More knock means more range, but it also, it's like a fine balance. So let's say I like the knock here. Okay, but it's too much high end. I can add a filter now to get rid of the high frequencies. Let's select this to 24 dB per octave. We need to get rid of the ew sound. And now we kind of get rid of the movement. So let's add some drive. Pretty low octave. Okay, so now the question is, how do we tame that lasery part? That's the tricky part to this. Now I would recommend you stack a kick and an 808, which is a whole different process, but just have enough punch in the 808 to where it can hold its own if you had to play it by itself. Also mess with your attack. Okay, so that's the basics. Let's go to the effects and let's start filling out the sound. Let's add some distortion. We're gonna switch it to tape mode. There's other modes like soft clipping you could use as well. Turn up drive. And now you're getting more saturation out the sound. Now I wouldn't drive my 808 that much. Let's try soft clipping. Sounds better to me. It's still super low frequency. Now remember, this, the note values also matter. So there's a lot about 808s. So let's add this in the song mode. So you have to ask yourself, can you hear the 808? If the question is no, you need to add more tonality or more harmonics. So there's a lot we can do here. It just will eat up a lot of the time. Thank you. right, so now we have the 808. What I usually do is do the 808 in multiple stages. So I would drag the audio out. Now we have it as this, and then I would mangle this sound more. So I would go to this tab, maybe boost it, look at the waveform and say, what needs to change? Not much. It just needs a little like saturation, basically. So in this case, I'm going to use clip. I usually don't use clip. And it needs a little more punch in the beginning. So I would grab, this is why I said, grab the Lunch 77 kit. So you have some starter sounds. Now, what you could do from here is go to Metro Boomin's kit, for example, grab a small kick. You just need something with a little punch like this one. And then you grab your 808. Now, this is so convoluted. I'm trying to show you the basics. So we're going to stack two sounds. Now, the problem is these two sounds have frequencies in common. And I don't have my iLock in. But basically, I want to stack these two sounds. But the problem is one sound is turning off the other sound when it plays. So when this kick plays, it makes the other sound kind of go away. So the question is, how do you stack these? Okay, so that becomes the new journey. So what I need to do is send this to the mixer. I'll just show you the more advanced stuff. This is advanced. Hit control L, double click on this sound, hit control L. Okay, so let's name this 808. Let's name this kick. Grab your kick, and then you're gonna right click side chain to this track over your 808. Now we're gonna open up a multi-band compressor and solo only the lows here. This is again more advanced. We're gonna go to the expert tab, go to external input. So now it listens for an external key. We're going to go to the options, go to the settings, processing tab, right click, select your kick as the input. So now every time the kick hits, it lowers the volume of the lows so they don't clash. So now the question is, how do we combine these two? Okay, so here's where you need to be more advanced. We're going to pitch the kick down. And also this 808 is a little too high pitched, so we need to pull this down. So now the question is, how do you balance two sounds together? And this is the tricky part of 808s. That kick might be a little more boxy than what I expected. We just need something pretty simple and sine wavy like this. Okay, this might be a better kick to layer. There we go. This is what I mean. There's so many layers to this. I would process the sound and go back and then reprocess the sound. There's a lot of steps to an 808, a full 808. But this is just the beginning of what you could do. So right here, the phase is a little misaligned. So let's do this. There we go. So the clicky part was coming from the 808. So now I'm combining those two sounds into one. This sounds more like an 808 we would use. I'm gonna turn the volume down of the kick because I don't want it to go pa boom pa boom. I want it to go boom like that. You want to make your 808 so that you can stack them. Okay, so now we just gotta watch the volume of this 808. It's a little crazy. If I can find the 808, sit here. Okay, and then just mess with the volumes here. That's a pretty decent level. So what I would do from here is go to the master chain now, open up Edison, go to new, and I would make sure Edison's at the top so there's no other plugins. We're going to record. Actually, I can't talk, so I'm going to mute my mic. Go to new. We're going to record input. And then you would take this kick and you say, what needs to be fixed about this kick? So long story short, this portion right here where they overlap, I need to make sure that time matches better. I think I delayed the 808 a little too long. So in this case, I would either cut this out and just make it something like this to where it looks more like a single thing as opposed to two separate things. Okay, and that sounds like a better 808 to me. Okay, so we're gonna grab this, drag it inside of Edison or inside the playlist. You can normalize it from here just to make it louder. Now we're going to save this as our own 808. So let's save. So notice we had to take it outside of the plugin to do a lot of this stuff. And that's where a lot of folks get confused. They think you can only just use one plugin to make an 808. So that's why 808's a little more complex than just whatever you insert into a plugin. Let's add this 808 in. Now that we have our 808, let me drag it into the playlist so we could use it. Okay, so this track really doesn't need an 808, but let's just add one in. Okay, so now we need to give it tone. So I'm moving a little bit quicker here because this is beat making. Okay, so here we gotta get particular about the tuning. So certain tone, certain frequencies just hit harder with 808s. And that's usually the F and the G note. Can't really hear the 808 because it doesn't have a purpose in this track, but it's there, okay? And again, you can always do like what you do with any other 808, go to pre-computed effects, boost it, you know, add saturation. There's a thousand things you could do to it. I'm going to move a little bit quicker here because this is beyond the scope of what I'm trying to show you. I'm just showing you how much work you have to do to get a good 808. Also, just make sure you right-click cut itself in FL Studio so it doesn't overlap. And it's just going to have that sweet spot. So we made a hi-hat, 808, a snare, a kick. We made a pad. Let's just quickly move through brass, keys, lead. I have a lot to show you guys. I told you this is an ambitious video. Let's do layering and then let's do Foley sounds and then we'll wrap this up. So let's add a little lead in here. To move quicker, I'm just going to go back to our MIDI here. I'm going to copy this whole top section, hit control. Let's move to a new pattern. Open up another serum. Now leads don't necessarily need to be like sustained elements. So usually when you hear a lead, you think of like a G-funk lead where it's like, and it just keeps playing. So we're going to try that style, but if it doesn't match with this track, leads don't necessarily need to be sustained. So the main thing about a lead is it's usually a brighter sound that has a sustain, which means I could just hold the note. Okay, so the main thing about leads is that we have what's called mono legato on most of the time. So this adds for me playing one note at a time and I can create slurs. Like that G-funk sound. And that's usually what a lead is just mono and legato combined. So let's hear what it sounds like without any editing. Sounds pretty cool actually with mono. So again, let's use all those principles. I'm going to add this into the track, but then I'm going to shape the sound as we're listening back to it. First thing I'm going to do is add effects. Let's make it big first. Before I get into all the sound wavetable stuff, let's just make it big. Let's add hyper dimension. Reverb basically. Now notice if I add that hyper mode, it adds that unison effect. Also try octaves with leads. So I have oscillator A and B playing, but they're playing two different octaves. Now, I like the sound, I just want it to be a little more muffled. It's a little bright, okay? And I want that envelope to kind of pluck. So to create a pluck, we need to create a quick decay, similar to like, dunk, dunk. Okay, it's a small decay. Let's add envelope two over the filter cutoff. Remember, wherever it points to, that's the end point. So I can turn this all the way up, but as long as it ends at a lower frequency, it'll go, it'll close up. It's like me quickly putting my hand in front of my mouth, like this. Okay, creates a little. Now, see how it only did it the one time? That's because we never let up on the note technically. It still considers me playing all these notes as one note because they're overlapping. So the question is, how do you make it like doop, doop, doop? You can add it's what's called an LFO to have that same shape repeat itself. So this is what low frequency oscillators are about. Let's right click, remove all modulators. We're gonna grab LFO 1, drag it over top the cutoff, and then we need to set a rhythm for it. So let's say I want it every fourth beat, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4. You can set the rate right here. And let's select oscillator B and A to go through here.
And let's say you want to move this knob as it's doing that. Okay, you can do LFO 2, and we want to turn it up and down over time. So a triangle shape, basically. I'm turning it up and then turning it down over a certain amount of time. So now we need to select this and give it a rate of time. Let's give it 2 bars. So now the sound bounces around. Let's go back to the matrix. Let's add that cool note on alternative effect. You could also do note on random. Let's click oscillator A panning, left and right. Make it full width. And then we need to control the panning of oscillator B because we have 2 oscillators now. The volume, or excuse me, the pan, and then have it go left and right, but then the opposite direction so that they play. I keep forgetting that it doesn't consider these multiple notes because we're not triggering. But if I were to trigger, see how the sound evolves over time? And it gets panned left and right. So if you were to do that, that's a cool little feature. If you wanted another oscillator, you could add the sub oscillator. Let's make it more video gamey by adding that square wave or the pulse wave. Now remember, we didn't send the sub through the filtering. So add some reverb. Now on a lead, you would usually add delay on some level. So let's have the lead come in over time. So here's the lead by itself. I like it, but let's pull it down an octave, control down. Kind of muddy. So that's why I said leads usually live in higher frequency. And it needs those supporting chords to really have a life. Now let's just start leveling, turning stuff up or down. We have our pad, we have our lead. Let's create a bass to kind of thicken up. I'm going to get rid of the 808 for the beginning so the bass doesn't get too heavy. So for bass, you're basically going to focus around the sine wave and the triangle wave as your main waves. There's different bass types. If you want the Drake bass, use a sawtooth. Add multiple voices of a saw. Detune them and then add them through a low pass filter with a high dB per octave. Lower your cutoff and then increase what's called resonance. Then lower your octave. So you get that Drake Moog-ish bass. And then you would just add mono legato mode, but the main thing here is the portamento. So you slide from the, it goes, that's portamento. And that's how you make the Drake bass. That's a cool bass, let's try it. Let's copy that. And if you wanted to thicken up this bass, you could add what's called that sub octave. Okay, using the sub button and then make it 2 octaves lower, and then I could run it through the filter and it just thickens up the bass. Now we have a lot of notes here, so I'm going to get rid of all the higher notes so we only have the low notes. See how it's like, that's because we have such low frequencies that it starts to make a wobble effect. If I switch this to a square wave, you get more rumble because it's so low. It's like du-du-du-du-du-du-du-du. So if you want fake distortion, try an oscillator at a really low level in a pulse wave or a saw wave. That way you don't need distortion. It's pretty low. Okay, so if you want to widen it out, you could add chorus to your sound here. Widens out the sound, but because we already have unison, it's already widened out for us. So for a sharper sound, you would pull the detune in for a wider Drake sound.
You would detune this.
Let's add it. Let's hear it in context. Now we just got to make sure that the notes overlap just a little bit. Just a little bit. Okay, we're just going to drag these. Now again, if you want more like vibrancy out of it, you can go to the effects, go to filter, and then add that drive knob that I talked about. Now here we're starting to like go crazy with the clipping. So I would recommend sending this to a soft clipper of some sort just to tame the top end. Let's use T-Rex for now, because we have a lot of volume on that bass. Again, if you want a brighter sound, you would open up the filter here. So what you can do is, let me just show you real quick. You can record in FL, notes and automation. I'm going to move this knob over time. Oh, you know what? I forgot. I recorded into the envelope. So let's merge these. Hit Control G to make the envelope even bigger. So this is mimicking me on a real synth turning a knob. So let's record. That ended so fast. I thought that was much longer. Okay, so you can go further and further with it. Oh, you know what? I recorded on the second end, that's why. Making a bunch of bloopers today. Okay, let's start over again. Let's do this one more time. So let's go to let me just show you an FL real quick. This is beside the point. Go to current project, go to patterns. And if it says initialize controls, you can get rid of any automation there. Okay, so if it makes you reset, let's do this for a third time. Third time's a charm. Let's start over. So now I have built-in automation of me moving that knob. And I can go to the global tab and change the width so it's not so wide. Make some brass. Let's layer up the pad with the brass. Again, I'm moving a little bit quicker here because I don't know how long this video is. So I hope I have enough gigabytes on my computer. This may take 2 days to upload to YouTube. Who knows? Okay, let's hit Control V. Send this down to the mixer. Hit Control L. Now to make a brass sound, it's a simple sawtooth with. Okay, it just has a filter. And then we're going to give the filter an attack curvature to it, and then a decay curvature. Wow. Similar to what I did earlier with my mouth. Okay, let's drag the envelope over top the cutoff. So it goes wow, wow, like that. And you can lower the range here with the blue knob. Let's thicken up the brass. Let's give it like four voices. And then let's add another oscillator down an octave. Send oscillator B to the filter. So if you want it thicker, you can go lower and lower, but you got to be careful when you start stacking chords and stuff, having everything low octave make it too muddy. So you can switch the curvature. That's the brass sound. You can also mess with the pitch. I wouldn't mess with the pitch though for a brass sound, but you can. I'm just showing you options here. You can grab the envelope 3 and then give it an attack curvature so it goes up. And And also, I would try FM from B to add a little more texture. A little more metallic sound. And remember, we have two oscillators now, so we have to maintain our modulation on both so they have the same characteristics. Just gotta watch your volume here. Okay, so that's the brass sound, so we're gonna add that in. And again, you could add reverb. Let's solo this just so you can hear. To add some reverb. But before, let's do dimension in this case. Turn off the hyper mode. Turn the size up. That's all we really need. We don't need to go crazy with this. You can add compression to that EDM sound, add multi-band. Let's see how that fits in the mix. So this track is very loud. So remember to save your patches. Okay, so if you like something, just make sure to save EDM. I like that one. Okay, so lastly, we're gonna make a key patch. Now in this case, I'm gonna use what's called FM synthesis. So we're gonna use FM8 for this one. Okay, so that's everything. And then in Foley, I gotta figure out how to do Foley. I don't know if I have Foley sounds. I guess we kind of showed you Foley, which is that noise patch in Serum. Let me just show you real quick. In Serum, let's go to our noise, turn that on, and let's do something organic. Let's do an air can. Turn off oscillator A. And we should be able to export this noise. Let me see if it exports. It's hard to see. This should be noise we hear. Wait. Okay, so you can export that Foley from Serum. That's a quick way to do it. Okay, you can stack that over top stuff. So without further ado, let's open up FM8. This is a little more advanced. So we're going to go to the expert mode. Let's go to E. So basically, remember I said the big brother shakes his little brother. These are called operators, and if you right click on them, you could activate them. So I'm telling E to shake his little brother called F. And the faster he shakes his little brother, the faster his little brother gets shaken. So he's just going crazy. Okay, so with keyboards, it's mostly sine waves with different objectives. So I'm going to move a little bit quicker through this. Using the same principles. Okay, we need to go to operator F. We need to give it a decay curvature with a release tail. So now every time I hit a key, it needs to fade out and it needs to last pretty long. So I'm turning up what's called the release tail. Okay, now what I need to do is add a little attitude to the beginning of the piano. So E to F is going to give it the attitude. But the thing is, I want this to only happen in a short amount of time. So we're going to give it a short decay. So it goes doop, 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 like that. Now this envelope maker is very hard to work with. So you hear that little blip. Okay, now ratio is the frequency, so these work in ratios of 1:1. I'm gonna lower that, which lowers the frequency. Let's do 0.25. Let's lower this to about half the octave. Now we don't need to click every single time, but it adds that little knock we need on the keyboard. Now let's add another sine wave. Let's right click on D, give it direct output. Now I wish there was a quick way to copy and paste. I don't think there's a quick way to copy and paste. So let's just copy the same characteristics of the other envelope, give it a decay curvature and a release tail. This one's going to be more sustained. Now we can give it the volume here by lowering this down. Let's pan this one to the left and the other one to the right. Actually, let's keep this one center. Pan this one to the left and let's detune it a little bit. Here's where tuning comes into play. When you detune things, they create like a chorusy effect. Now let's add another oscillator C and pan this to the right and then detune it in the positive values instead of the negative value. Or the negative value instead of the positive. Give it a shape. And you can give these tones by feeding it back to itself, which makes it into more of like a sawtooth. Or you can have C modulate D. I like this type of sound. It's a little left heavy, so we need to turn down whatever's on the left. So now we have a pretty unique piano. Now pianos go way deeper than that. I just can't sit here for 2 hours and make a piano. That's the basics. So from here, you would just modulate the filtering, or the amount, I should say. And let's drag this pattern 10 over here. Again, this is going to take probably 2 hours to upload to YouTube. Forgot to add effects. You could also add effects, delay, flange, or reverb. Okay, let's reverb, and then we need chorus. We really don't need delay and chorus. All right, these headphones are starting to take a toll on my head. But again, the piano needs more of a hammer down effect on it. I just don't have enough time to create that for you. Your sound design masterclass from beginning to end. You guys saw everything. So if you want to learn more, just go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. The link will be below. Subscribe if you're new. Like the video. Let's help some more producers around the world. Peace out, guys.